I remember you, precious Jesus. I remember you, healer of my heart, lover of my soul.
Welcome to First Lutheran Church, where you're among friends in Christ. I'm Reverend Thomas Rothy. I'm glad you've joined us today, and it's my prayer that the Holy Spirit, working through the gospel, touches your heart and changes your life. May the Lord bless you today and throughout the rest of the week. Old Testament lesson is recorded in the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel. We read the 16th chapter, beginning at the first verse. David was anointed as the king of Israel. He was chosen for a special task. Jesus was God's anointed one, chosen for the special task of redeeming us. We read. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king." But Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me." The Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You are to appoint for me the one I indicate." Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, "Do you come in peace?" Samuel replied, "Yes, in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, "The Lord has not chosen this one either." Jesse then had Shammah pass by, but Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse had 7 of his sons pass before Samuel, but Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went to Ramah. Here ends our first lesson. Today's second lesson is recorded in the Epistle to Titus. We read the 3rd chapter, beginning at the 4th verse. Through the saving merits of Jesus, we are justified, that is, declared not guilty before God. Through our baptism, we have become heirs of eternal life, we read. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Here ends our lesson. Alleluia. You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Alleluia. The gospel lesson for the day, of which a portion will serve as our sermon text, is recorded in the Gospel of St. Luke. We read the 3rd chapter, selected verses. John the Baptist points to Jesus as true God, the promised Messiah. The Holy Spirit and the Father confirm John's testimony that Jesus is the anointed Son of God. We read, "The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, 'I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire.' When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Here ends our gospel lesson. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Once again, our sermon text for this morning is a portion of today's gospel lesson. Dear friends in Christ, have you ever noticed how favorite meals have special ingredients? Maybe the special ingredients are a special meat, pasta, or spice. Whatever the special ingredient happens to be, it made that ordinary food a meal that became a favorite. The portion of God's Word that we have before us this morning doesn't focus on a favorite meal with its special ingredients, but it does focus on a favorite and a special ingredient. A special ingredient that, when added to something ordinary, makes it special. The favorite that I'm referring to is baptism. The special ingredient, God's Word. This morning, then, let's meditate on the theme, "There's something in the water." We'll see, first of all, it's God's Word, and secondly, that it delivers salvation. This morning's sermon text picks up where the third Sunday in Advent's gospel lesson left off. In that lesson, the focus was on John the Baptist's call to a life of repentance in preparation for the first advent of the Messiah. Now, since we find ourselves in the church season of Epiphany, today's sermon text focuses on the revealing of Jesus as the Christ for the entire world. So his baptism is prominent. Our sermon text tells us, when all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." There's definitely something in the water of baptism. And that something is God's Word. Luther's Small Catechism defines baptism as the sacrament in which water is used in the name of the triune God to bring us into the family of God. So what starts out as something simple becomes something very special when God's Word is added to it. The form that God's Word takes in baptism is the name of the triune God. Did you happen to notice that all three persons of the triune God were present at Jesus' baptism? We're told that the Holy Spirit descended on Jesus in the form of a dove. That God the Father spoke approvingly of his Son. And when God the Father spoke, his words represented the second person of the Trinity, God the Son, who, as John described in his gospel, is the Word made flesh. Luke makes special mention of the fact that as Jesus was being baptized, he was praying. Have you ever wondered what Jesus might have been praying at this moment? Most likely for blessings on his upcoming ministry. Some point to Jesus' baptism as his great coming out. Now he was being revealed as the fulfillment of the promised Savior's coming. The one who was to come to take away the sins of the world. Others like to point to the descending of the dove on Jesus in bodily form as his anointing. Remember, that title Christ literally means the anointed one of God. We have examples of this in both the Old and New Testaments. Isaiah records God the Father saying, "Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations." And as Peter preached in Acts, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Jesus' baptism, then, was his anointing as the Christ of God. As I mentioned earlier, God the Father spoke approvingly at his Son's baptism. He was happy that his Son was being baptized, that he was shown to the world as the promised Messiah, and that he would accomplish the mission of redemption that was assigned to him. One thing that Jesus' baptism wasn't is that it washed away his sins. Jesus has no sin. But he was baptized as one bearing our sins. You see, Jesus joined his baptism with the baptism of all sinners in order to take their place. Jesus' baptism as our substitute was a part of his work of redemption. There is definitely something in the water of baptism. And what it delivers is salvation. In Luther's Small Catechism, under the section of blessings, under the category of baptism, the question is asked, what does baptism do for us? The question is answered, baptism works forgiveness of sin, delivers from death and the devil, and gives eternal salvation to all who believe this, as the words and promises of God declare. Prior to Jesus ascending into heaven, he left his disciples then and now with instruction to teach and baptize. Why baptize? Because it saves. The blessings that baptism imparts are customly broken down into three specific blessings. The first is the forgiveness of sins. Again, as Peter stated in Acts, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. The story is told that when Martin Luther went to Rome for the first time, he did the customary things Roman Catholics do to earn the forgiveness of sins. One of those things was to climb on one's knees the same steps, reportedly, by which Jesus entered Pilate's house in Jerusalem. According to one report, halfway up the stairway, Luther heard a voice. The righteous will live by faith. He immediately stopped and thought to himself, how foolish to be climbing these steps to obtain forgiveness, when all the time, God has forgiven my sins. Luther climbed no farther. The second blessing is deliverance from death and the devil. As the writer to the Hebrews penned, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death, referring to Jesus' death, he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. The account of Noah and the flood is sometimes used to illustrate this idea of deliverance. Just as Noah and his family were delivered from the floodwaters that brought certain death, they were saved through that ark that God had Noah build. Well, in the same way, all believers today are delivered from the devil and the punishment of death, not through an ark, but through the suffering and death of God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ. The third blessing is eternal salvation, or as we sometimes call it, eternal life. As Jesus himself stated, "I am the resurrection and the life." Jesus could so confidently say this because his resurrection from the dead really did conquer death and usher in eternal life. The account is told of a soldier who was mortally wounded in battle, but was able to crawl back to his tent where he later died. Under him was a Bible, and where his hand was resting on the page, the words, "I am the resurrection and the life," were transferred from that page to his blood-stained hand. He was buried with those words written on his hand. And undoubtedly, those words were also written on his heart, along with Jesus' words, "Because I live, you will live also." There's something in the water of baptism. That important something is God's word. And what it delivers is salvation. Let's remind ourselves of our own baptism. And let's keep reminding ourselves of our own baptism. And do it daily. It really is God's way of saving us from sin through water and the word. God grant it for Jesus' sake. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Spending some time with us today. You have been watching First Evangelical Lutheran Church of the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. Reverend Thomas Rothy invites you to tune in again next week, or if you have the opportunity, to worship with us live on Sunday morning at 9:30. First Evangelical Lutheran Church is located at 231 Smoke Tree Lane, Prescott, Arizona. If you are in need of spiritual assistance or would just like more information, please call 445-2807. May God's word guide you this week.